the opportunity to speak in this August forum, and I am very happy to be here at Imphal. This is my first visit to Manipur, and I was looking forward to the opportunity to visit the state. So thank you to the organizers and for the opportunity to come here and speak. Now I have got some cases also. If time permits, we'll go through the cases. Before that, we will come to the main topic, which is overcoming challenges in the implementation of AMSP in hospitals in private and public sector. So this, I think, are the main challenges with regard to antimicrobial stewardship program. What is the source or the genesis? The genesis is lack of adequate training. If you look at our MBBS curriculum, or even the MD and the DM curriculum, or MCH curriculum, or MS curriculum, there is not much coverage of topics like infection control. There are chapters on antibiotics in medicine. There are chapters on antibiotics in pharmacology. But just take out a standard pharmacology textbook or a standard medicine textbook from 5 years or 10 years back. Even now, you will struggle to find a chapter on antimicrobial stewardship program. Okay, so you are taught, or most of us sitting in this audience, be it nursing or physicians or surgeons, we are taught what are antibiotics, how to treat clinical syndromes. But we are unfortunately not taught till now in vast majority of our hospitals. And remember, we have about 300 medical colleges in this country. And every medical college has about 100 medical students. So that is, India is producing something like 30,000 doctors every year. Out of these 30,000 doctors, it would be a surprise, even 3,000 of them, that is 10% of them, know what is antibiotic stewardship program. So there lies the problem. So we are not being taught from the MBBS level how to judiciously use the antibiotics. We are taught about a lot of things: side effect of antibiotics, drug interactions, dose, route of administration, what is the pharmacology of the drug, what is the pharmacokinetics and the pharmacodynamics. But how can you treat a patient with the narrowest spectrum agent safely, effectively, with minimum cost, that is not taught. The second problem or the challenge is the conflict of interest. Now, what are the different types of conflict of interest? So there are institutional conflicts, there are departmental conflicts, and there are individual conflicts. So what are these different types of conflicts? So the institutional conflict is that, let's say you have two hospitals, and these are two private sector hospitals. There are high-end antibiotics being sold in both these private sector hospitals. And sometimes the price charged to the patient is more than the MRP of the drug. So they will say these are administrative charges. Now, if you have a very high-end antibiotics, that cost will be high, and the administrative percentage will be even higher. So one institution may make a lot of profit just by selling antibiotics. And the other institution, which is trying to be judiciously using antibiotics, may make less profit. Now we are in a profit-oriented world. So there is an institutional conflict over there. Where is the departmental conflict? Before I go to the departmental conflict, the institutional conflict can also manifest in different other ways, even at the departmental level. One is that, let's say you have a microbiology department or an infectious disease department which is trying to implement stewardship, be it private sector or public sector. Now there is another department, let's say pediatric department or surgery department or obstetric department or medicine department or intensive care department, which is trying to do things on its own way. So there is a clash between two departments. So there is a departmental conflict. So one department may say, who are you to check me? It is my patients. I will decide what the policy would be. So that is why you need to have administrative support in order to implement AMSP. And then there is individual conflict. How can individual conflict occur? So let's say in the same department, let's say you are talking about a medicine department or a surgery or an intensive care or pediatrics or obstetrics. There are two doctors. One doctor is prescribing antibiotics which are high end, and there is another person who is using antibiotic judiciously. Because another person is using very high end antibiotics, the other person comes under peer pressure. That okay, my colleague who is maybe junior to me is using so much of high end antibiotics, or senior to me. Or sometimes we try to follow what our seniors do, what the head of the department does. So if the head of the department is not interested in antibiotic stewardship, it is very difficult for the junior to do antibiotic stewardship. Very difficult. There is also administrative support. See, administrative support, it's easy said than done. So in order to have administrative support for antibiotic stewardship policies, ICMR once conducted an AMSP meeting where only the CEOs, the director, the principal, or the medical superintendent of the hospitals were called. Because unless they are on board, they support the AMSP team, the AMSP process, support the AMSP structure development, no AMSP program can survive. Okay, so it is not there in many centers because the administrators are also doctors. In private sector, they may be non-doctors. If they are non-doctors, the situation is even worse. They are looking at only at a profit point of view. However, if the administrators are doctors, they may be at an age or seniority where AMSP was not there when they were in medical schools. So they don't know. If they don't know, how will they implement AMSP in their own institution? The fourth is formulary and its restriction. So what is an antibiotic formulary? So you have I think it's relatively easy in government sector because the government may buy L1, the lowest one among the quotations. So there is one brand available. In private sector, it is not the case. So you may have multiple brands. Now what you prescribe eventually depends what profit are you to get out of a brand. So the MRP may be something, but the pharmaceutical company may be supplying that medicine to the hospital at a rate much lower than MRP. So the gap will be different for different brands. And depending upon what is the profit, a private sector hospital may keep certain brands and may not keep certain brands. So there is a conflict there. And even the individual prescriber, let's say there are two brands. One brand, pharmaceutical company comes to the prescriber as a doctor and says, sir, if you prescribe 100 patients meropenem, I will send you to America for a conference. Okay, so this sort of incentive may be given from pharmaceutical company to the prescriber. If you prescribe 100 patients colistin, I will give you a holiday, free holiday. So there are pharmaceutical incentives also going on. And there are implementation challenges. So there are leadership challenges because somebody has to lead. It's a lot of additional job in addition to your routine job. And if you look at the job description of an institution, so let's say I am microbiology or I am a medicine head of the department or whatever. It's not written in my job description that antibiotic stewardship program is my job. So I currently it is not there. So I do it because either my director asked me to do it after I have joined, or I do it because I think it is important. So it is, nobody is being appointed currently to do antibiotic stewardship. So because it is not there in the job description, what I do is an extra. So I may not do it. So it is not there in the organizational structure at the moment. And it is also a stressful and thankless job, because be it pre-authorization or prospective audit, you have to talk a lot, you have to come into conflict, and these conflicts may raise your blood pressure. And so, and nobody is going to tell you that you are doing a good job. The patient is getting better. If the patient gets better, actually the primary physician or primary surgeon will get all the credit. If the patient does not get better, it is possible if you are doing antibiotic stewardship, you will get the blame. Okay, so it is a thankless job and a stressful job. So these are the principal challenges. Now, what are the issues in the public sector hospitals? What are the problems? Now, the public sector hospital, you know, government funded, the infrastructure may be inadequate. So you may not have in place an AMSP team, because the AMSP is not there in the job description of anybody. So if it is not there, so I will not do. That's it. There are resource constraints, so there are not pharmacy, or pharmacists are there, but they are busy in other jobs, or doctors are there, but they are busy in other jobs. Human resource not sufficient or adequately trained. There are too many patients. So let us first do the routine job. After that only we will think about others, things. There may not be any IT support. So information technology in the hospital has become a very important tool. So those hospitals which have got laboratory information system or hospital information system, it is relatively easier to do AMSP, because you can see all the results online, previous result, 5-year result, any result you can see online. So it's easier. You can see the clinical history also. You can see the diagnosis. You can see the reason of admission. You can see all the investigations. So it's easier to do. But if they do not have it, it's a problem. And administration will always have other important priorities. Okay. So AMSP, okay, but I have to increase the number of beds. I have to renovate this. I have to recruit people. So there is no end to job. So the administration may say, we have other things to do. You do this. Microbiology lab in many government hospitals may be non-existent or inadequate. And as I said, without microbiology lab, you cannot have an AMSP. And pharmacy not having appropriate and adequate antibiotics or antifungal agents. So this is another problem. That see, antibiotic stewardship is not just reducing broad spectrum antibiotics. It is actually giving the right antibiotic to the right patient at the right time in the right way. Now, if there is antibiotic resistance, you need meropenem, you need vancomycin, but they have to be available in a government hospital. If it is not available, patient may die. So these are the problems in the public sector. Next. Now, what are the challenges to the private sector? Private sector primarily is driven by profits, because their raison d'etre, that is the reason that they exist in the market, is because of profit. AMSP may not be a profit-making service, so it is a lot of additional work, but it may not be visible that it is translating into certain profits. Although there are studies to show that AMSP on the whole is profitable, because if you reduce antibiotic consumption, if you reduce infection rates, it is beneficial to the patient. If the patient is benefited, you will have more clients, more patients in future. But that is a long-term outcome. It is not a short-term outcome. So those hospitals in the private sector which are looking for short-term gains, AMSP is not profitable. That's the general impression. Leadership support. Admit may not like to disturb doctors who bring in profits. So what is that? So let's say there you have a cardiothoracic surgeon or a neurosurgeon who does not believe in antibiotic stewardship, who uses very broad spectrum antibiotics, very costly things, for a prolonged period of time. But that person is a very good surgeon. Patients get better. Okay. Now, if you say in private sector, I am going to stop that doctor from using broad spectrum antibiotics, the CEO of that hospital, the director of that hospital may not tolerate you. He or she, that surgeon or that physician, may be more important for my business than you as a microbiologist or you are an AMSP champion. So I don't want you. You keep quiet. Don't disturb him. Okay. So that's another problem. The next is lack of adequate training. See, AMSP requires a lot of clinical microbiology, infectious disease training. If you do not have adequately trained people, and these training are not easily available also, because our microbiology training is still mostly laboratory based training. Medicine training is, there are not enough ID physicians being generated in the country. The number of infectious disease DM courses are handful. Microbiology doctors not clinically oriented, again the same. And incentives from pharmaceutical company, I told you that you prescribe 100 patients cholesterol, you will go to USA for a conference. Okay, so it's like that. Next slide, please. But there are some strengths. So everything is not dark. There is also light. So what are the light? Physical and building infrastructure much better than most private sector. So there is a lot of space in public sector generally. So you will see that most private sector hospitals are one building. Whereas government hospital, very large area. Okay. So if you want to have a separate office for an infectious disease physician, a separate clinic, a separate lab for a microbiology, or separate other infrastructure, a pharmacy, there is space in the public sector. There is no space or little space in the private sector. Generally, public sector has more human resources, like in medical colleges and central institutes. If you see the private sector, most of the microbiology labs have got one microbiologist or even half microbiologist. What is a half microbiologist? You don't cut the person in half and keep it. Basically, what you do, one microbiologist is serving two labs or three labs or four labs. Or sometimes a pathologist is signing microbiology report. So there are not enough staff in the private sector to do microbiology, let alone antibiotic stewardship. And public sector is not driven by profit. It is for public good. So that's another thing. And if government is in your side, that is the side of AMSP, many things can be achieved. So basically those countries, like Western countries, UK, Germany, Netherlands, Australia, Canada, USA, those who have done good work in AMSP, that is antimicrobial stewardship program, it is because the government is by leaders who know what is antibiotic. Okay, so another challenge before us is that we have to make our policy makers, right from Prime Minister to Chief Minister, know what is antibiotic stewardship. So if you can make your Prime Minister aware about antibiotic stewardship, if you can make your Chief Minister, the secretaries of the government aware about antibiotic stewardship, aware about infection control, aware about antibiotic resistance, and they are on your side, half of the battle is won. Because if the government wants, anything can happen. Anything can happen. Okay. Private sector hospitals, what are the strengths? One advantage of the private sector is that the recruitment is much more flexible. You want to join? Well, come tomorrow. Okay. I don't want you. You don't come from tomorrow. Okay. So, it is like that. Okay. So, there is a recruitment which is relatively easy. So, they can bring in experts from various areas. Nothing called retirement age. As long as you are compass mentis, you have a sense and you can move, you can talk, you can work up to 90 years also. No problem. Okay. So there is a flexibility of recruitment and retention in the private sector. Many good IT infrastructure for lab information system and hospital information system are there in the private sector. higher antibiotics, antifungal agents are more readily available. So patients dying because antibiotics are not there, it's not common in private sector. Patients may die because they cannot pay the price of the antibiotics. But if they can pay and you have a treatable infection with an antibiotic in private sector, you will be having that antibiotic. Okay. Relatively better lab infrastructure in terms of automation and other advanced technology. In microbiology and other laboratories, also in diagnostic sectors like radiology, imaging, etc. Greater propensity to get NABL accreditation, and this may put the processes like MSP in place. So if you go by NABL or NABH accreditation, which many private hospitals do because to be more competitive in the market, many things will come into place, because the NABL requirements, the NABH requirements particularly, would require AMSP to be one of the important quality parameters. Next slide, please. So how do you overcome the challenges? So there are a few things one has to do. First of all, but if you are, sir, you are asking about the checklist. So this is one of the checklists I could think of. Firstly, we have to enhance our bacteriology QC and ID AST. So if we are very good in quality control, in bacteriology, mycology, in terms of identification and antibiotic susceptibility, it's a very good start. So the clinician should have a very good confidence on the authenticity and accuracy of the microbiology results. The second thing to do is develop a hospital antibiogram based on blood cultures. So these are small steps, but these are very, very important steps. So develop a hospital antibiogram based on blood culture results. Forget about other samples first. Blood culture, you will have less doubt about whether it is a contaminant or not. So an E. coli in the blood culture is almost always significant. Whereas an E. coli in the sputum may not always be significant. Okay. Third is, develop hospital antibiotic policy. Okay. So start small. Start with those departments which are friendly to you. And then go to more difficult territories. So antibiotic stewardship and infection control are two things which require very good communication skills, very good interpersonal skills, very good diplomatic skills. So if you are a very straightforward person, you talk tough, you are unlikely to be very successful in this, because you have to be very diplomatic. Okay, so let's have tea, and you will be surprised. Most of the major decisions are made not in the classroom, not in the offices, but actually they are made over a cup of tea, in the canteen, on the corridors, in the lift, walking along the stairs. So if you are a friendly person, you are more likely to succeed. Revise standard treatment guidelines, antibiotic policy based on yearly antibiogram. That is another very important thing. So see, the antibiogram is not a constant thing. It will change. And because the antibiogram changes, the standard treatment guideline may also have to be changed. So the first line antibiotic, which might have been piperacillin tazobactam for hospital acquired pneumonia 5 years back, now it may be meropenem, because the antibiotic sensitivity has changed. Most of the strains may be pipped as resistant. Prescription audit and feedback has to be done. Prescription audit and feedback. Again, start small, then aim for big. And department-specific antibiogram and antibiotic policy. So if you go by this stepwise approach, it is very likely you will succeed. Next slide, please. So this is over. I have got some cases. Sir, you can... We'll finish the case? Okay, thank you. So we will do some case-based discussion. Are there any burning questions? I can answer them now before we go into the case-based discussions. I've got 5 cases to discuss. Okay, we'll finish the cases. So first case, please, first slide. So these are just real-life cases. Patient is an intensive care unit due to snake bite. Are there snakes in Manipur? There is snakes in Manipur. Okay. Most of India has got snakes, apart from maybe very high altitude areas. And after the snake bite, the patient develops acute renal failure and requires dialysis. So the patient has got a femoral venous catheterization done for dialysis. And subsequent to that, develops a fever, chills, hypotension, and a blood culture is positive. And there is gram-positive cocci in blood cultures. The identification and sensitivity of the blood culture positive, gram-positive cocci is awaited. It's still not ready. The question is, which antibiotic for empirical therapy to be used? So I've got five options over here, which are coamoxiclav, vancomycin, ticoplanin, daptomycin, tigecycline. Okay, so if I could ask the audience, how many will you use daptomycin? How many will you use daptomycin? Is daptomycin an antibiotic used in this hospital at all? Not used. Okay. How many will use tigecycline? How many will use tigecycline? Is tigecycline used in this hospital? It is used. So, anybody who wants to use tigecycline, if not, why not? See, for every, this is the clinical microbiology AMSP role, and I will show you. So, in this given clinical situation, these options may come out. So, five doctors may want to use five, or there may be another 5 or 15. Now, you have to counter as an AMSP champion or an AMSP leader or a member, why to use and why not to use something. So, daptomycin is actually a third line antibiotic for gram-positive infection. So, first line may be cloxacillin, or the second line may be our cloxacillin or coamoxiclav. Second line may be vancomycin, ticoplanin. If you want to give oral treatment, it could be linezolid. And see, after all of these, you come to daptomycin. So daptomycin is a very high-end antibiotic. It is costly. And so before using such a drug, you have to know whether the lesser options are available or not. So that's why you do not use that generally. It's particularly used in VRE bacteremia, so vancomycin resistant enterococcus bacteremia, where other drugs are generally resistant. Tigecycline is not a drug which is used for bacteremia because its blood levels are not very high. So, and it is bacteriostatic, it is not a bactericidal drug. How many may use vancomycin or ticoplanin? How many will use vancomycin? Anybody to use vancomycin? Now, you may use vancomycin, but the problem is the patient has renal failure and the vancomycin is nephrotoxic. So, it may add on to the renal failure. Okay, so not a good idea to use vancomycin unless you are doing vancomycin therapeutic drug level monitoring. So, that is serum vancomycin levels, which are not easily available in most parts of the country. So, you may use ticoplanin because it is less nephrotoxic than vancomycin. Vancomycin is twice a day and ticoplanin is once a day. So, advantage. But you may also use coamoxiclav, which is a relatively cheap drug. So, now if you have MRSA or you are suspecting MRSA or the patient has previous MRSA, you are more likely to use ticoplanin. Whereas if the patient previously has MSSA, which is sensitive staph aureus, and you are not suspecting a very unstable patient, if the patient is unstable, you may go broad spectrum. If the patient is stable, you may go for narrow spectrum. So here, the correct answer, depending upon the previous microbiology, it may be coamoxiclav or ticoplanin. Okay. So, question two. So, another patient in the intensive care unit. And now, this patient was admitted with H1N1 influenza virus. and developed acute respiratory failure and got ventilated. So I suppose you have got quite a good intensive care unit, a big intensive care unit where ventilated patients are there. Now this scenario can occur, and influenza occurs throughout the country, and this patient remains ventilated for 5 days. The patient develops fever with increasing fractional inhibitory oxygen concentration, fractional inspired oxygen concentration, or FiO2. So the general FiO2 when we are breathing air from the atmosphere is 20%. Now this patient, it is 40% or 60%. Sometimes it will be 100% also. So the total air that is going on to maintain saturation is much higher than the oxygen in the air. So that means the patient has got a respiratory problem and has also got increased respiratory secretion. So you have to suction the ventilated tube, and when you suction the ventilated tube, you will either get secretion or no secretion. Or if you get secretion, you may get watery secretion or bloody secretion or purulent secretion or sticky secretion, lot of different types. And there is new consolidation in chest X-ray. So the diagnosis here is, anybody? Is VAP, ventilator associated pneumonia. So because it is ventilator associated pneumonia, you have these options: piperacillin tazobactam with amikacin, oseltamivir with azithromycin coamoxiclav, ticoplanin meropenem, daptomycin tigecycline, meropenem with polymyxin B or colistin. Okay, so these are the options. So what to give in which situation? Anybody?
H1N1, then I'll go for the second one. But if it's post is H1N1, then I'll go for the first one.
Okay. Yeah, so sir is saying that if the patient has just come in, you need oseltamivir with azithromycin and comaxiclav. That is correct. But, you know, the patient initially was treated by that B combination. Because the patient initially came with community acquired pneumonia. But subsequently developed hospital acquired pneumonia while on ventilator and developed ventilator associated pneumonia. So in that situation, you may wish to continue on oseltamivir. But azithromycin and coamoxiclav after 3 days, it may not have any role. Okay, because you have already detected influenza. So you have to treat for ventilator associated pneumonia. So what would be the optimal combination for ventilator associated pneumonia? You said something, sir. First one. Yeah, actually, piperacillin tazobactam with amikacin is a good first line agent for ventilator associated pneumonia, provided your piptaz resistance or meropenem resistance is not high, or amikacin resistance is not high. If it is high, then you may have to go for meropenem and polymyxin B with colistin. See, daptomycin, tigecycline, both are useless in pneumonia because they don't get into lungs. Okay. Ticoplanin, meropenem is another option. Provided you have staph aureus infections and MRSA is suspected, then ticoplanin with meropenem is another option you can use. So you have to know the pharmacokinetics of the drug. The pharmacokinetics here is daptomycin and tigecycline are inappropriate for the treatment of pneumonia. So you would never use it irrespective of the microbiology. Next, please. Case 3. So patient in surgical ward after hemicolectomy. So one part of the colon is taken out, and intestinal anastomosis. So after the colonic resection, the end-to-end anastomosis has been done. Post-operative day 6, develops pain abdomen, fever, tachycardia, hypotension, abdominal distension. CT abdomen suggestive of anastomotic leak. However, the surgeon does not want to reoperate because he thinks that the patient is unstable, may die on OT table. So wants to give just antibiotics and observe and supportive care, conservative management. So the question is, which antibiotic for empirical treatment to be used? Coamoxiclav with gentamicin, vancomycin with amikacin, ticoplanin with meropenem, ticoplanin with meropenem and fluconazole, and tigecycline with colistin.
Breathe like this. So, second one will be very good.
Second one, vancomycin, amic acid. Yeah, vancomycin, amic acid is a reasonable combination, particularly in the public sector setting where other high-end antibiotics like colistin, meropenem, etc. may not be readily available. And they are reasonably broad spectrum. So I would agree that this is an option in a public sector setting. Problem is that both these drugs are nephrotoxic. Both these drugs are nephrotoxic. And if you have an ESBL infection, let's say, or an AMC infection, which are resistant gram-negative bacillary infection, amic acid may be suboptimal. It may not, so there are problems with this combination. Anybody would like to use fluconazole? Anybody would like to use fluconazole? Not initially. Okay. Now, yes. So, yes, I agree that initially antibacterials should be used because first line antifungals are not really indicated in most of the cases unless you have an immunocompromised patient. So if this patient was, let's say, post chemotherapy for a colonic carcinoma and the patient's neutrophil count was down, then you may think, or this patient is an HIV positive patient, then you may think of antifungal. But the patient is at risk of fungal infection because abdominal surgery has been done. So there is a risk of fungal infection. So I would say vancomycin amic acid is a reasonable combination. But if the patient is on septic shock, okay, so shock is infection with organ dysfunction. And there is some evidence of shock that here hypotension is there. But you know, you may treat the shock with fluids alone, or you may treat the shock with fluid, antibiotics, as well as vasopressor agents like adrenaline, noradrenaline, dopamine, dobutamine, etc. So if your shock is correctable with fluids, then you may go for a narrower spectrum antibiotic like vancomycin amic acid. However, if the shock is not correctable with the first line antibiotics and fluid, you may have to increase the spectrum of antibiotics. So then you may have to think about meropenem, colistin, and if they don't respond, then eventually antifungal agents. Next slide, please. Yes. Yeah, sir is asking, just go back to the previous slide, please. So anaerobic infection. Actually, it's a very important question that we have not actually included, you know, metronidazole in any of them, despite the fact that it is an abdominal infection. An anaerobic infection is a real possibility. The reason is that coamoxiclav has got an anaerobic cover. Meropenem has got an anaerobic cover. If we were using piperacillin tazobactam, that also has an anaerobic cover. But if we are using vancomycin with amic acid, sir is right, we should use an metronidazole. Because none of them, vancomycin or amic acid, has got anaerobic cover. And we should cover for anaerobes. So we should use metronidazole along with it. But remember that if you are using a carbapenem, like meropenem, imipenem, if you are using a piperacillin tazobactam, if you are using piperacillin tazobactam or coamoxiclav, so these are the BLBLI combinations, beta-lactam is inhibitor combinations, metronidazole may not be needed. So I will finish in two more slides. Case 4, which is a penultimate case, 7-day-old preterm neonate with fever, poor feeding, tachypnea, blood culture negative, but CSF shows pleocytosis. Pleocytosis in the CSF means increased number of cells in the CSF. Low glucose, high protein, so there is signs of meningitis actually, or meningoencephalitis, and there is gram-negative bacilli. You know, gram-negative bacilli causing meningitis is not common in adults. Unless that adult is immunocompromised or has got some neurosurgery or shunts, etc. But in neonates, it is a problem. So these are mostly maternally acquired, and those babies who have got vaginal delivery and preterm, low birth weight, poor infection control practices, they have a higher risk of getting a neonatal meningitis from a gram-negative bacilli. Now the antibiotic therapeutic options here are ceftriaxone, gefotaxime with amikacin, ampicillin with gentamicin, meropenem with vancomycin, or intrathecal colistin. So colistin is being given into the subarachnoid space. So what would you do in that situation? Yes. Second. Okay. So cefotaxime, amikacin is a wonderful answer. Ceftriaxone we generally do not give to neonates because it can cause some cholestasis problems. In some centers, people give ampicillin with gentamicin also. Okay. Now, I personally believe that cefotaxime, amikacin is a better combination. Because number one, gentamicin is more nephrotoxic than amikacin. Number two, the coverage of cefotaxime is better than the coverage of amikacin. There is one exception only, that is if you are to cover an organism called Listeria. Listeria monocytogenes causes neonatal meningitis. But that is a gram-positive bacilli. It is not a gram-negative bacilli. If you are to cover for Listeria, you may give add ampicillin again on cefotaxime and amikacin. Meropenem vancomycin is too broad spectrum for initial treatment, and intrathecal colistin is generally not given like that unless you have detected a very resistant carbapenem resistant gram negative bacilli. Okay. Next. Last case. 35 year old, and this is my last slide. 35 year old woman, 3 days after vaginal delivery, develops burning sensation during urination. Dipstick of the urine shows pus cells, not pus cells, and nitrite. So neutrophils in the urine and nitrite positive. So dipstick we are doing very frequently, and they can detect both WBCs as well as nitrite. And the patient also has fever. So what would be your empirical antibiotic? Coamoxiclav with gentamicin or amikacin, nitrofurantoin, ticoplanin with meropenem, ticoplanin with meropenem with fluconazole, tigecycline, polymyxin. Huh? Nitrofurantoin. Okay, any other opinion? Nitrofurantoin.
But we can add fluconazole also, itching.
Okay, okay. So actually, nitrofurantoin is a good choice. The only disadvantage of nitrofurantoin is that in patients who are potentially bacteremic, nitrofurantoin's blood level is inadequate. So nitrofurantoin cannot be used to treat bloodstream infection. So how will you know the patient has bloodstream infection? See, if the patient only had local symptoms like urinary symptoms and no fever, the chances of bloodstream infection is remote. But because this patient is having fever, there is a small possibility that this patient may have a bloodstream infection. Okay. So you may give nitrofurantoin because a fever can also occur from local infection. There is nothing to say that fever cannot occur from systemic infection or only systemic infection. So you may give nitrofurantoin, but you have to tell the patient that if you do not get better, then come back to me, I will consider something else. Anybody will give coamoxiclav with gentamicin. Somebody said fluconazole. Actually, candida causing UTI is reported, but it's not very common. Okay. Now, it is being increasingly reported, but the significance of candida in the urine, it is definitely a cause of UTI, but it is certainly not in the first few. The commonest is E. coli followed by Klebsiella, then there is Pseudomonas, then there is Enterococcus, there is Coagulase negative Staphylococcus. Then a few patients may have candida. And again, the candida in the urine may come from vaginal candidiasis. So you do not know whether it is actually representing a urinary isolate or a vaginal contamination. Okay, so that's the problem. But if the patient does not get better and you are detecting candida or seeing candida in the urine microscopy or growing candida in the urine culture, then you have to consider fluconazole. The last two options, tigecycline, polymyxin, I have given because, again, in the pharmacokinetic reason. Tigecycline's excretion is hepatic. And polymyxin is not as well excreted in the urine as colistin. Okay, so these two are not really urinary antibiotics. So you have to know what is an urinary antibiotic and what is not an urinary antibiotic. Teagoblanin and meropenem in this setting looks like an overkill. One can give coamoxiclav with gentamicin or amikacin. Advantage is that coamoxiclav can be given orally. And gentamicin, amikacin, you can give once daily dose, either IV or IM. So if you have a patient who is not getting better with oral antibiotics, you can consider giving once daily aminoglycoside in amikacin or gentamicin, provided the renal function is all right, and then see what happens. Thank you, sir.